Ying from New York University. Right now, I'm a PhD student working in future reality lab with advice by Professor Ken Perlin. So we are so honored to be invited here to give a short talk about our idea of virtual reality and kind of future reality. So right now, let's strongly welcome our charming dear Professor Ken Perlin here.
Hello, everyone. Welcome from New York. I am exactly halfway around the world. So to make it even more difficult, I'm going to give my presentation about the future by trying to give you an idea of what the future might be like. So imagine I am in a future reality, and future reality, anything is possible because we have entered the age of computer graphics. Now, you might think we already are in the age of computer graphics, but I don't think we are. I think we are in the age of phones, we are in the age of computer monitors, but when computer graphics is floating in the air between you and me, I think that is when the age of computer graphics will really begin, because that is when we are going to be able to have conversation with each other, with computer enhancement between us. So let's ask ourselves a philosophical question. What is virtual reality? People are thinking recently, oh, virtual reality is these headsets that I wear, but actually, I think it's a much deeper question than that, because I think in order to ask what is virtual reality, we have to ask what does it mean to be human? So what is it that humans care about? You think about all the things we care about. So here is a landscape of things we care about. Maybe somewhere there is a mountain, maybe there's a country, maybe there's a book, but in fact, humans actually care about something very specific. We care about, we see another human, and then we see another human. And when we see other humans, then we see other human minds. Then we get very interested, and our interest goes enormously high. And I would argue that what we are really interested in is the connection between us, and all of our minds are focused on this. And we build culture, we build bridges between one human mind and another human mind. And this aspect of being human, I think, is the most important part of what we are. And that means that for us as humans, objects are not merely objects. If I talk about a chair is not merely a chair. It is an object of language. It's a semantic idea that we all have that we share between us. A table is not just an object, it's actually something that is utility and use. We think about putting things on tables. We think about bringing tables next to chairs. And then there are some physical objects in our world that have even more abstract meaning. So for example, clock represents time, which is an abstract idea that we speak about, but you can't touch time, you can't feel time. It's real, but it's real because we think about it. And because of this, we take physical objects and we start combining them and creating new functionality. If I talk to you about the idea of air and air conditioning, yes, there's a physical object, a fan. But a fan isn't merely an object. A fan is also an information object. And in the modern world, you could imagine I connect the idea of a chair to a fan. So if somebody walks in and sits on the chair, the fan starts to blow. And if the person gets up and walks out, the fan stops. So this isn't just things. This is us taking our minds, pushing it out into the physical world around us. And this is fundamental. It's not about computers. It's not about instead, it's about how we have always worked as a human species. Because we work this way, we start doing things in a very specific way, because what connects us is the shared instinct that we have, which we evolved over hundreds of thousands of years to be able to learn language. And language is the big connector. So I would argue that virtual reality should not be an experience for one person. Virtual reality should connect us, because everything we do, a book, a movie, a story we tell, everything connects us. And the next coming generation of virtual reality technology needs to serve the same purpose. Let's talk about the next 10 years, starting in 2016, moving to 2026. What will happen in the next 10 years? Well, right now, when we think of virtual reality, we often think of something very specific. We think of a variation on something like this. There's a box with two holes in it, and we look in that box and we see into another world. The problem is, we're holding this thing in front of our face, and we're hiding ourselves from each other. This is not what people are about. This isn't the answer. Well, soon, in the next 5 years, we are going to see an evolution of the underlying technology. We're going to start seeing that instead of these boxes, the objects that we create these virtual visions, are going to start looking more like glasses. They're going to be much more accessible objects, much more lightweight. They're going to have tiny little micro displays in them, maybe 4K by 4K micro displays. There's going to be, as these micro displays change color, we're going to see it in front of our eyes, but we'll be able to see the reality in front of us. There'll be some way that the light goes through these things, and we won't think about them. We won't think about them any more than we think about these things. We are going to transition from the brick in our pocket to the wearable. Once everybody has the wearable, we forget about it. It will just be part of reality. And this is very important, because this means that we will walk around our world, our everyday world, and we will see objects that only exist because we're all seeing them with our glasses. We will see virtual objects, we will see virtual creatures, and we will just accept these things. So at New York University, we have been doing experiments to try to understand what might that future world be like. And for a while, it was very difficult. And then about 2 years ago, we started getting the modern era of virtual reality devices. So in around September of 2014, a little more than 2 years ago, we started experimenting with the Gear VR, which is the very simple VR headset that uses a phone and can track your orientation. We combine this by putting markers on it with a motion capture studio. And the motion capture studio allows us to have a group of people walk around in this space and share an experience freely walking around as though they are in a future reality where everyone is wearing those future glasses. So some of our experiments I will share with you today. You might recognize the person in the center of the image as Zhenyi, who did the introductions and is with you today. Let me show you a video that shows an example of what you can do and the kinds of activities you can have when people share these things. We, for example, created the ability for people to draw in the air in three dimensions. I'll show that to you right now. Thank you. Did that come across the video?
Yeah, it is.
Okay. So then once we realized that we could allow people to share these experiences, we created other experiences. We decided that it was very important that we have a way of talking about this. So we refer to an idea that has been in American popular culture for many years, the idea of the holodeck, which comes from the television show Star Trek, where it's a science fiction television show where people can enter a virtual reality together. But the most important thing about this is that it's not an experience for one person, it's an experience for people to share. So we say that the holodeck is other people, because that is the most important thing about everything we are doing. Here is an example of another experience we did to celebrate something that's popular in North America, Mexican Day of the Dead celebration. We decided we would create a shared experience of this, which I will show you now. We invited several hundred people to come in and enjoy and play with this experience together and do all sorts of shared activities. Into a shared experience. So last weekend, 1 week ago, we created a very large experience for 30 people all in the same room. Everybody believes that they are a bird, and they're in a flock of birds, and they're flying around sharing this experience together. And we called it Flock. What happened here is that they didn't just see
Okay, we're gonna have a couple more for you.
Oh, yeah. That's wrong video. Sorry. So when you see these shared experiences where these people are in these worlds together and having these fabulous activities, you realize that it has this sort of psychological effect on people. That I think is very profound. People are starting to have a Actually, I might be able to show you one more video if I can do it properly. Hold on. Hold on. I can find this. I'm going to show you one more video because I think it's very exciting. We just made this just now. Can you see that? Zhenyi? Can you see anything other than me?
No, I only see you going at which.
Okay, then I'm going to change the screen sharing, okay? Okay, so I'm going to share a different screen for this screen. Right now. And now you should see the same video, right? Can you see it? Except we'll skip forward. Oh, it's not working, is it?
Yeah, it's not working
now. Reload it. Now we're going to skip forward and we're going to show you what happens behind the scenes. So all of the people are communicating with each other as though they are birds. And they're all having a great time because they believe that they're in another world, a world which is a magical world. And it turns grown-ups into children while they're doing this. Now I'll go back to the presentation.
I can only see you if you need to share the screen here.
That's okay. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. So what this means for us, this idea that when you take people and you bring them out of their regular life, and you put them into an enhanced world, a world where more things are possible. And you could see those people in that video, they were having a richer experience of reality because we're evolving the possibilities for how they can communicate. And if we take this idea of evolving how we can communicate, we think, hey, I could draw, and the drawing I draw is right in the air. It's magical. And we keep going with that. What happens next? What can we do with this? Well, imagine that you're in a future in which anything I draw in the air comes to life. So, for example, if I'm trying to explain to someone the idea of a pendulum, and I can draw a pendulum, but then I might say, well, I'm drawing a pendulum, that's very interesting, but perhaps I want to ask questions about the pendulum. So I draw another object, and I say, let's connect this object to that object somehow. Oops. Can I do that? Can I connect the objects? There you go. And then when I swing the pendulum, you can see the information from this object. If I have a pendulum that's shorter, it swings at a different rate. If it's longer, it swings at a different rate. And I think this idea that I can communicate with you visually in a way that's just part of our conversation between us in the air, I think is going to be a very important part of the future. When I teach computer graphics, I use techniques if I want to teach people, for example, an idea of how texturing works. So some of my own work in procedural textures, this looks like it's a three-dimensional planet. It's not really a three-dimensional planet. It's actually a computer graphic illusion. In fact, you can see it's perfectly black. When we ask the question, how do we bring this to life? Well, I can show my students actual code that's running inside of the hardware of the computer. This is a very powerful concept that I can do this. So for example, I can say, let's take some number here, and I've just changed a number and that has gained something inside of the math that's happening in the graphics processor, and immediately students see a change. Now, I can only do this now through a computer screen, but when we are wearing these glasses in the future, I will be able to do this by drawing in the air between us. And there are many things that we'll be able to do. For example, Zhenyi works on some projects where we take physical robots and we use these physical robots in virtual reality. Here, let me show you an example. This is an image of Zhenyi making a robot come toward her simply by saying, with a gesture, the robot should come toward her. Now, this is an enormous power she has, and I hope she uses this power wisely, for good. And what we'd like to do once we're wearing things is say, not only can we see things which are not there, but also we can choose to not see things which are there. So for example, if she's wearing the glasses, the robot might be invisible. So she might be able to say in the future, well, there's an object across the room, I want it to come toward me. And actually, a robot brings it, but she doesn't have to see the robot. It becomes a kind of magic. So imagine we are living in that world 5 or 10 years in the future. And I am having a conversation with you, and I'm saying to you, I have this idea for some pottery class that I took, and I draw the sign. The language that I'm using now is called Choctaw. And Choctaw has all of these tools in them, and we are gradually moving it out to shared virtual reality. This is the sign in Choctaw for, I'm going to create something as though it was on a potter's wheel. So I want to have something with a particular profile. So I draw it, and I say, okay, that's my profile. And immediately, the computer graphics constructs an object that looks like that. Now, maybe you and I are having a conversation, and because it's the future and we're wearing these glasses, we really see this object as though it's sitting on the table between us. But of course, we cannot touch the object. The object is just made of empty air. But I can say, well, maybe I want to pick a color for this or a material, some nice clay material, and then you and I, we go off to lunch. And then meanwhile, while we are at lunch eating, this gets manufactured on a 3D printer. And then a robot comes and brings the physical object and places it in the same place. We come back from lunch, and now our object is ready. We pick it up. It's a physical object in our world, just as real to us as this object. And that is something that seems like magic now, but in the future will just be reality. Now let's say I do this thing and then you want to contribute. And remember, the computer computation is floating in the air between us because we are in the future. So you say, well, I like that shape, but I have my own idea for a shape. So you draw something and you say, I'm going to attach my idea to your shape. And now, any change you make, I'm using your curve that you drew, changes my shape. And now we are doing collaborative design together. And just in real time between us, we are changing this design. And we're doing it as part of a conversation. Just the way we discuss ideas now, today, we can make ideas happen in the world during the conversation. Let's continue this conversation. Suppose I say, well, I like that curve, but I don't think that that curve really is right for this pot, but I have another project that I have been working on. I've been working on an animation. In fact, I have a little animated character, a little animated fish. So there's my little animated fish, and I think that this shape that you've made is a really nice animation path for my fish. So I attach them, and I say, let's make my fish animate using your path. Now we can start editing the animation path through the same tool that we used for the shape of the pot we can say, hey, I can apply this to the movement of the fish. This is something we do all the time in language. We apply different verbs to the same noun or the same verb to different nouns, except we will be able to see our language enacted as though it's happening in the world around us. This is a very powerful concept. It means that we'll be able to talk about real things the way we talk about ideas. We can talk about a light bulb. We can talk about the idea of saying, hey, what is electricity but something that gets converted into light? And we draw this and it becomes real. We can discuss more abstract ideas. Suppose I say, I have a light in my room and I want to set up something so that every time somebody walks into the room, maybe the light responds. So I draw a camera. Now, somewhere, we don't care how because it's the future, somehow the fact of doing this is attaching the idea of a camera to the idea of a light. Somewhere there's a real camera, but we don't care about that because we have robots that care for us. And then now that we've attached that, we can do something simple like say, hey, anytime I make a gesture, like waving my hand in front of the camera, it turns on the light and I have light in the room. And every time I gesture the other way, it turns off the light. And this idea of changing the world around us becomes not something we have to build and construct, but simply something we can talk about. And this is what is going to be happening in 5 or 10 years in the future. Now, I use these ideas to teach, and I teach computer graphics. So I'm going to give you an example of a lesson that I give when I teach computer graphics. One of the things that's very difficult for my students to understand is how objects transform in computer graphics. And so, for example, here is a coordinate system, and we know it on a picture, it only looks 2 dimensions, but in fact, it's really 3 dimensional. And we want to talk in computer graphics about taking objects. Here's an object, simple polygon shape, and we want to talk about how that behaves when we drop it into a coordinate system. Let me make it a different color so it'll be easier for you to see the object. So there's an object, and it's being seen inside of the coordinate system. And now I want to discuss how do we do things like rotate the object or make transformations to the object. We have tools that we use in computer graphics, mathematical tools to do things like this. So for example, one tool we have is something that we call a matrix. A matrix is a 4x4 array of values, and the simplest matrix does nothing, but then we can start having different matrices. We can have a matrix that moves things, and this is the mathematical structure of that. We can have a matrix that rotates things. So for example, if we want to rotate things about the x-axis, we need a matrix that does something with y and z, something with sines and cosines. And this is what that matrix looks like. Now, if we have a visual language and I can just talk to you and explain things to you, then I can simply say, well, why don't we attach a value to that? And then when we change the value, we're changing the numbers in the matrix. And now we can use the matrix as an object, not just as a noun, but also as a verb. We can say that matrix is the operation that changes what happens when this object goes into this coordinate system. So as I do this, you see the object starts to rotate. I can, of course, rotate it by greater amounts. So now the object is rotating faster. And now I can explain to my students the relationship between the picture of rotation and the mathematics that they need as computer scientists to make it happen. Rotation about the x-axis, rotation about the y-axis, which goes like this, because I'm leaving the y-axis alone. Now maybe I want to get a little more sophisticated than this. Maybe I want to explain to them some more difficult semantic concepts, such as time. Well, we talked about time before. We can bring it back. Time is an object like any other object, but time has an effect on things. So instead of talking about an angle, we talk about how fast the angle changes. Now this object on the right is animated. It can rotate about the y-axis, about the z-axis. And in this way, we can construct complex ideas simply by drawing them and discussing them with each other. And then I'm explaining this to you, and maybe you draw in the air, you explain something to me, and we go back and forth and have an entire intellectual conversation with all of these objects. How are we doing with time? Okay. So, I personally am very interested in some particular topics. For example, I'm completely fascinated by the idea of four dimensions. I love four-dimensional objects, and if I could, I would live in the fourth dimension. So, here is a cube. It's actually a hypercube. It's really a four-dimensional object that's floating in space. And one thing I should point out about everything you are seeing is that the tools that I am showing you today, these tools actually are being done in a web browser. So they just exist on the web. I'm using what's called HTML5, which is a fairly standard way of delivering three-dimensional content over the web, only using JavaScript and readers. So, for example, I could render everything that you're seeing, I could render on my phone just by going to the same web page that I have here. Also, if you put on a headset, you can see this in stereo. This is a stereo view from virtual reality. And everything that I've drawn, even though it looks like it's two-dimensional, is actually three-dimensional. And if you and I were seeing it with your glasses, it's already ready for us to be able to see this thing floating in the air between us as though it's a physical object that we could look around from different positions. So in our lab, we are building this infrastructure, these tools. Now, I'm interested not just in three-dimensional objects, I'm also interested in these virtual characters that come to life. I'm interested in saying, as we draw a character, the very fact of drawing the character should make it appear in our world. So here is a character that is alive because it has properties, I can give it interesting colors, it can have behaviors, so it can dance, it can walk, and it responds to me. And you can imagine a future where I want a character like this in the world, and I just have to draw it in the air, and it lands on my table and responds to real objects and responds to people. And this could be a relatively three-dimensional object, but it could also be a very abstract object, like maybe I want to talk about a bird, and I want this bird to be part of a story I'm telling. I should just be able to draw a picture of the bird, and now the bird comes to life. So maybe the bird is interested in us as much as we are interested in the bird. So for example, right now, because the bird is living in this world, it's interested in my cursor. So as I move the mouse cursor, the bird is very interested in it. And it's not merely curiosity. This particular bird is interested in this cursor because this bird is very ticklish. Now I'm tickling the bird, which it likes very much. And then, of course, eventually the bird gets bored and it leaves. And then we never see it again. So, but in the future, it will keep coming back because the creatures will be part of everyday reality. So I'd like to sum up by saying that in my culture, we have two ideas that tie this together. We have the idea of Harry Potter, who is a magical wizard who draws with his wand and creates things in the world. And we have the idea of Harold, who's a little boy in a children's story, who can draw anything he wants with his purple crayon, and then it exists. And I think that what we're creating here with the future is Harry Potter meets Harold and the Purple Crayon. We're creating the possibility that children will live in a fundamentally richer world where their language will be visual. And I think the most important thing is to think about how these children communicate, because the way they communicate is going to evolve along with the richer tools that we give them. And really, the target customer for everything we are making is that next generation, that young mind that shows up and is ready to learn whatever it is that we have to teach him or her. And I think everything we do really needs to be about that next generation. Thank you. Okay, cha-cha. Good night.
But the thing is that while people, humans' nature is that while we want to play with each other together. So I want to introduce one of my ongoing projects, that is a robotic haptic proxy for the collaborative virtual reality. That is, when we are not with each other, we are in remote places, how can we hang out with each other? We can use the help of the robotic. Okay, it should play automatically. Yeah, so you can see that. Right now we have two players here, they are in different rooms, you can see they cannot see each other. So this is our whole setup. They are wearing the correct headset, yeah, and they are wearing the wrist. So that's the view in their headset. They can see each other. They can see there is a shared space. So they are playing tic-tac-toe right now, and they can see their movements. So, but actually, this is the physical view, so that we use the robots as our invisible assistant. They cannot see the robots itself, but they can see the proxy. They can see the representation, like this is a cylinder controller. So you can see they can control each other's robot with their own robots. So, at the right player just move the robots, and the left controller just go to the exact same places. Well, here is the view from their own headset. We can see that's how it moves, and exactly that's how another player can see. So, and this is another scenario that we can support people. They are doing chairs with each other, even they are not in the same place, and they can feel the haptic feedback. That's what we really want. And this is the thing my professor just showed, that we can do the telekinesis with our magic power. So we can push it, we can pull it, we can finally pick it up. The thing is that finally we can pick it up because, well, it is real. It is not just virtual reality. We are doing this physical sharing stuff so that you can feel it, but it's still everywhere. So, well, thank you very much.